My brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you again to another Sunday reflection. As you would have observed and would have been told, I was out on vacation for a few weeks. But I want to say a special word of thanks to Sister Keisha Lowe, who really kept the reflections going and has done such a splendid job. I was saying to her that maybe we should keep her doing a few more of these reflections over a period, because she really has done a splendid job. And thank you, Sister Keisha. We thank all other persons who have worked in the congregations, both in Lilliput and in Mount Zion and Barrytown, in my absence, for those who have done teachings, like Mrs. Boyne, like Dr. Bert Redway, Reverend Redway, and for those who have preached locally, the lay pastors, Pastor Boyne, we have lay preachers like Mr. Gilzean and Mr. Malcolm and Sister Chapman, and all of you who have shared in the local ministry, the elders and members of the board who have kept things going. We want to thank you very much for those who have spearheaded things in one way or another. We want to celebrate your gifts. And so we welcome you both here in Mount Zion, Barrytown, Lilliput, and by extension, Farmites, for those who have held things together there too. And we know that God is doing a great thing. He's doing great exploit. Just want to begin by announcing the Joint Day of Fellowship that will take place this fifth Sunday of October. And this time around, we're doing pulpit exchange. So I will go to another church. Another pastor from another congregation will come to our church, but we'll still have a wonderful time in the Lord. This time around, we're hoping to host it at Farmites, and we will give you some more information on that. But the Lord bless you, and welcome again to Sunday Morning Reflection. Trust that God is doing a new thing and wonderful thing among you, and we want to start today with a song that I used to love playing, both playing and singing, Building a People of Power. We're a people of power.
Power, and I'm making a people.
brothers and sisters, we are building a people of power, and we are making a people of praise that will move through this land by the Spirit of God and glorify God's precious name. Father, we thank you for the church which you have placed upon this earth, and you have given us the ministry of peace and reconciliation. We thank you for the Holy Spirit which orders your church and organizes it and empowers it for Christian ministry and service. We thank you for all the leaders that you have placed within this pastoral charge. O God Almighty, those you have gifted, we pray that you will continue to lead them in the pathway of righteousness. We pray, O God Almighty, for elders, members, group leaders, teachers, preachers, O God Almighty, and we pray that you will strengthen them. We pray for all the membership that you will grant them grace, grant them the peace which passes all human understanding. We pray for those that may be broken and are going through situations, O God, that you will heal them even now. Heal them of all diseases. We pray especially for Sister Roper's sister in Canada, who is experiencing some weird sicknesses. We pray that your Holy Spirit will reach out to her right now. And if there is anything that the devil has put upon her, O God, we ask you to break it. We pray that you will touch her organs right now. And everything that is sick, that is ill, you will reverse it in the name of Jesus Christ, by your power and by your Spirit. May you heal all those that are broken, those that are sick physically, mentally, emotionally, psychologically, and in otherwise. Set them free by your power and by your Spirit, God. In the name of Jesus, heal your church. Let us rise up and be a people of strength. In Christ's name we pray. Hallelujah. Are you want to be a part of that people of power that we're building even now? That the Spirit of God will characterize God's church and lead us into victory and prosperity. Brothers and sisters, today I want to talk to us about the community, a strong community, elements of a strong community. I want to view community in all forms. The church as a community, the family as a community, but even the wider community that we live in, how we can make them strong. The people who make up the church come from a family, and the families come from a community. The people who make up organizations come from the same families and the same communities, formulating the church and all the organizations that do exist. And so if it starts bad in the context of the family as a community, the wider community in which those families reside will definitely be the quality that stem from the families. And the same thing, we get the people in the church, in the schools, at the business places, even in government, and in all the organizations, the security forces, wherever they go to work, they start with those same attitudes that they would have developed from their families. So that's what we want to look at, elements of a strong community. Hear what the Bible says in Psalm 127 and verse 1. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keeps the city, the watchman wakes, but in vain. I want to read that again. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keeps the city, the watchman wakes, but in vain. Father, open our eyes to your word, and may the word be transformative in nature, and that the power that lies within the word through the Holy Spirit will break forth in our hearts and in our lives. Now, a community may be simply defined as a group of people living in the same place or having certain unique characteristics, sharing certain commonality. By extension, they may have certain attitudes and interests in common. The community is normally where people live, where people work, where people study, where people play, and where people worship. And so whatever is the nature and the quality of this community will be reflected in the lives of the individuals which who emerge from these communities. It is felt that a strong community is where people have a commonality of goals, where members find freedom of expression, where members' concerns are addressed with sensitivity, where policies and obligations are clearly outlined and defined, where there is fairness, where there is the celebration of community heritage and traditions, and when there is the promotion of a spirit of cohesiveness and interaction among members, these things will create a strong community, brothers and sisters. Now, where these things are absent, then definitely it will create a weak community. The community is strong when it is characterized by certain things such as good leadership. Every community, whether it's your family, the church, the wider community, the nation, the city, good and credible leadership is of critical importance. Vision for those communities, the vision for the family, the vision for the church, the vision for the wider community, the vision for the nation. That's what the Bible says, where there's no vision, the people perish. There also has to be, though we have the vision and good leadership, but we need to have passion. And we have to trust each other as we work collaboratively to bring those vision to fruition. The writer of our text seemed to feel that an essential characteristic of any good and strong community is a community where God is at the center of it, the hub of it. So we hear the writer saying in Psalm 127, verse 1, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keeps the city, the watchman wakes, but in vain. The principle the psalmist is purporting here is that all human efforts may be rendered in vain unless they have God's blessings. These principles seem to be applied to four eras of human life and existence, as is outlined in this text. One, in building a house, or by definition, a family. Except the Lord build the house or builds the family, those who build labor in vain unless God is at the center. And we see it in our nation that we are not emphasizing the importance of having God at the center anymore. And what has happened to the nation as a whole? The level of depravity, senselessness, senseless killing, people growing without heart and without soul because God is not at the center. Whether it's a church community, our wider community, our families, except the Lord build the house, the marriages, we labor in vain that build it. God must be at the center, must be at the hub, as the psalmist is saying. Secondly, that the strong community is going to be a community that is, unless the Lord guard the city, in guarding or providing security for a city or community, except the Lord keeps the city, the watchman wakes, but in vain. And what this is actually saying is that there are security measures that may be put in place, like grills and like security guards and like guns and like all of these things that we may think we need for security. But the Bible is saying, unless the Lord keeps the city, unless the Lord keeps the city, the watchman wakes, but in vain. You see, because God is not sleeping, and God's unseen eyes are always watching, we need to pray and to allow God's presence to keep our city. I think some time ago a politician said we need God's intervention to deal with the situation of crime, and some people laugh him to scorn, but in essence we do need God's help, because fighting with guns and all of these things, These things are not going to stem the scourge of the wickedness that we see. Unless the Lord keeps the city, the watchman wakes, but in vain. But the psalmist also went further in saying, in working long hours for success, it is vain, verse 2 says, for you to rise up early, to sit up late, and still eat the bread of sorrows. What this is actually saying, that you'll work long hours, you labor the way you should, you get your pay, but you see, you still cannot experience the increase. So, the Lord is the one who gives the increase. And unless God is at the center of your work and life and activities, you cannot experience the level of fruitfulness and blessings and prosperity that you ought to experience. Vain for you to rise up early, as some of us do. Some of us sit up long hours, but in the end we still eat the bread of sorrow. No fruitfulness, no prosperity, and no blessing. The psalmist also emphasizes, for a city, for a community, for a home, the psalmist emphasizes that in having children, right, for the purpose of procreation, for perpetuation, and for the continuation of community, and for the preservation of our legacy and our community heritage, because verse 3 says children are a heritage of the Lord. Now, we have children, and we try our best as parents to instill certain values, but let me tell you, unless God is at the center of the lives of our children, unless we cover them under the blood of Jesus Christ and allow his angels to go over their minds, spirits of evil and demons will capture them and lead them astray So in having children, and it's important because children, the Bible says, a heritage of the Lord. If you work hard and you don't have any children to carry on your legacy, it's like you're working in futility. So children are a heritage of the Lord. So in the perpetuation of community and in the perpetuation and procreation, brothers and sisters, if the Lord is not at the center of the lives of our children, and as we have them, then our future is going to be bleak. One of the things we were talking about the other day is to see the number of organizations that are targeting children. There are communities that are organizations. Last week we had a frightening episode in one of our schools. Somebody deliberately went in and sold how many of our children some ganja lace sweet, which caused them to be ended up in the hospital. What is the purpose for all of this? What is the purpose for targeting our nation's children? Simply because if the devil controls the minds of the children, then he controls the future. Brothers and sisters, unless the Lord build the house, we labor in vain that build it. Unless the Lord keeps the city, the watchman wakes, but in vain. It is vain for us to rise up early, sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrow. And remember, children are a heritage of the Lord. It is very possible to accomplish all of these things which I have just mentioned without God's blessing, but it is possible to accomplish all of these things, yes, without God's blessing, but it is totally impossible for us to accomplish them and to allow them to be accomplished purposefully, right? Purposefully and with eternal value, lasting eternal value, without God's input and without God's blessing. So this is why the writer is saying it is vain for us to try to accomplish these things without God. In building a house, in guarding a city or a community, in working long hours, and in having children. Hear what Psalm 33 and verse 12 says. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he has chosen for his inheritance. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he has chosen for his inheritance. In other words, the nation that put God at the center, as the psalmist is saying, or the community is one that will become strong, will become viable, will become fruitful, and will endure. Righteousness exalts a nation, the Bible says, but sin brings reproach. If we must foster the spirit of a strong community, then there are a few things, four things I want to share with us before I close. One, if we're going to foster the spirit of a strong community, one, we have to foster a spirit of unity. In simple terms, any community that is going to be strong, a strong community, must be characterized by a spirit of oneness, oneness of mind, feelings. There must be concord and harmony among members. Any community, whether it is in your family or in the church or in the wider community, organization, institution, that people are pulling in different directions, then it is not going to survive. It is going to be destroyed in short order. In our text, in one of our scriptures, the Old Testament lesson, our Old Testament passage, the Bible says in Ecclesiastes 4 and verse 9 to 12, it said, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. Verse 10 says, for if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Verse 11 says again, if two lie together, then they have heat, but how can one be warm alone? Verse 12, and if one prevails against him, two shall withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. And you see, you try to lift a stone with one cord, it breaks. With two cords, it breaks. They break, maybe. And with three, it holds, or they hold. It's a sign that the three cords, the three strand cords, are stronger than one. It is telling us that any community that they stand together, our family, that stand together in commonality, in what you do, in unity, that is going to be strong. That's why Jesus prayed for the unity of his church. Father, make them one as we are one. You know what Jesus says in Matthew 12 and verse 25? It says, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. And every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. I read that again, Matthew 12, verse 25. Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. And every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And if you read the entire passage, you will see that not even Satan's kingdom can stand if it divides against itself. The kingdom of God, the church, the community, no community can stand if leaders are divided against itself. I think that's why we have not made much more progress in this nation, because we're always trying to find ways to tear down each other, to destroy each other, to fight against each other, to badmind each other, and so on and so forth. The second point I want to make, that if we're going to foster a strong community, we have to foster a spirit of genuine love. Not love in pretentiously, but genuine love. Any community that is characterized by a strong love bond will stand. Any community without genuine love will fall apart by spirits of covetousness, vindictiveness, unforgiveness, service out of duty rather than a service out of genuine love and passion. Yeah? Bad mind and envy will seep in if the love principle is not operating in any community. Any community where people are self-propelled, they are about themselves, what they can get, what they want, instead of what the community wants, that community will fall. If there is no genuine love in the heart of people, right? No spirit of forgiveness, there's going to be spirit of vindictiveness, bad mind, a spirit to tear down instead of building. Hear what Romans 12, verse 9 to 10 tell us, let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. In other words, let love be without hypocrisy. Let love be by, voluntarily given in terms of caring for others. Genuine and unfeigned love should characterize the community. Verse 10 says, be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly and sisterly love, in honoring, preferring one another. 1 John 3, verse 16 to 18. The Bible says, hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. Right? He laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for one another. Wow. Verse 17 says, but whosoever at this world goods and seeth his brother or sister have needs and shut up their bowels of compassion from such ones, how dwelleth the love of God in us? What do? We throw it away instead of sharing it. Verse 18 says, my little children, let us not love in words, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. You see, there are so many of us who are quick to say, we're quick on the draw to say, I love you. Yeah? But do we love genuinely? Or do we just speak it? Or we just say it from our lips? But do we really, really love? Because words are easily spoken. My little children, let us not just love in words, but neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Love should manifest and demonstrate itself, in other words, in practical ways. The third point I want to make is that the strong community, if it's going to be remain strong, community must foster what we call a spirit of peace. Because in any community where there is no peace, whether in the house, in the church, in the wider society, no matter what you work for, can be destroyed in no time. The Hebrew word shalom is a word which lies behind the word peace from a biblical perspective and refers most commonly to that which is uninjured, that which is unbroken, that which is safe, that which is whole, whole, and sound. The word is somewhat multidimensional and speaks of completeness physically, psychologically, socially, and spiritually. Flowing from all aspects of one life, speaking in a sense to everything being put right with God, put right within oneself, and put right with our relationship with each other. The community that does not experience peace can have its entire fabric being torn apart. Because you may have a lovely home, but if there is war in that community in which the home is situated, there is no way that you can live there comfortably. So the peace of the community is important. If there's somewhere that you work, but there's this contentious spirit that prevails within that environment, how can you continue to work there? Although that's where you're getting your bread, but you will be looking for the first door out of there. The peace of God, the Bible says. Hear what Philippians 4 and verse 7 says. It says, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. It would want to seem to me that it is God who gives lasting peace. Whether in your heart, your mind, the tumult and turmoil and the challenges that you face in your own personal life, the challenges we face in community, in families, in relationships, it is the peace of God which passes all human understanding that can keep us and keep our hearts. The Bible says it will keep us in perfect peace whose minds are stayed upon. The peace of God is that tranquility of mind which frees us from all fears and worry. This is peace divinely bestowed in anxious moment, which stand as a sentinel or a guard around us, keeping us and our community steady in the midst of troublesome times. Brothers and sisters, may God bless you and may God keep you. May God let his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Shalom, brothers and sisters. Nothing lacking, nothing wanting in your life. God bless you until next week.
Couldn't ask for more. I'm coming back to your prayer.